Once, and not that long ago, there was a summer that seemed perfect. Rome, 1960. In Southeast Asia and the Middle East, in Eastern Europe and Africa, places that had been and would be again the scene of destruction, there was relative calm. The world was napping. For better and worse, so was America. Then, long before Nintendo, tag in the front yard might have been the game of choice. 36 years ago, the music doo-wopped and rocked and rolled about the trials of teen romance, but never spoke about a society corrupted by a cruel color line. The 1960 American Olympic team flew off to Rome on smoky, plodding, propeller-driven DC-7s. On those planes were five Americans who would transform those Olympics, and then, in their own ways, shape the decades ahead. Three decades before Barcelona, there was a dream team, one without portfolio. The co-captains, players of imposing ability, were city and country, black and white, two who would cherish the bond they formed as much as the gold medal they won. There was the decathlete from Steinbeck's, California, who had established a logic-defying friendship with a rival from the other end of the world. Rome was the first major stop on a long and storied world tour for a teenage boxer who trained by racing the bus to school each morning in Louisville's West End. And Rome was the canvas for a dashing triple gold medalist who outlasted a childhood of poverty and illness in Clarksville, Tennessee. 36 years ago in Rome, all these rich destinies converged. Jerry West and Oscar Robertson, the Magic and Michael of their time. Rafer Johnson, who won perhaps the greatest competition in Olympic history. Muhammed Ali, who became the most recognizable face on earth. And Wilma Rudolph, whose stirring victories in the games of the 17th Olympiad will forever be a flashpoint in the history of women's athletics. Five of the most extraordinary athletes in American history. Once, they were suspended together in a sporting paradise. 36 years ago, they were the wonders of Rome. Time when a nation prospered, yet wrestled with a promise unkept. How it long excluded so many from its fountain of opportunity. You found a willingness of the heart. Bound by your own secret, you'd be someone special. So what if all you knew was telling you otherwise? Each day, you measured the distance between who you were and who you hoped to be. Until on warm Roman days and nights, in the last games of innocence, you showed the world the power of a child's secret.
Think of Rome, it's obviously with a lot of warm feeling.
I love to talk about the Olympic days. Those are the days when really we were unaffected.
It was a time when I don't think we heard much of the discussion of steroids or drugs.
Because now when you go to the Olympics, I guess it means instant riches, but during those days it was just an honor and a privilege to go and play.
The idea of professionalism wasn't something that people thought much about.
Fun and joy was just something that you cannot really explain that easily.
That was the most incredible experience I've ever had in my life as an athlete. It was the purest that an athlete can be.
They were kids in a feel-good time wedged between Elvis and Dylan. Most had never been this far, to a place where the narrow streets squiggled like a snake, and piazza upon piazza formed a dizzying maze. Just getting here was a major accomplishment for a promising, garrulous Olympic rookie with an acute fear of flying. But such timidity was not evident in his opening work of art. August 30th, 1960, with a rapid-fire attack, Cassius Clay quickly disposed of Belgian Yvonne Beckhouse, a blur matched against a plodding light heavyweight. In Rome, Clay's mouth was working just as fast, and his boldness endeared him to Olympic flag bearer Rafer Johnson.
Probably the reason I connected with him so well at the very beginning, and he became such a good friend of mine, was that he was really just the opposite of what I was. I mean, here was a guy predicting he was going to win the gold medal. Now, that's exactly what I wanted to do. I wanted to be a person to win the gold medal, but I didn't dare open my mouth and say that I'm going to do it. So I think that's why I liked him so much, is he just was flat out predicting that he would be the gold medalist.
Like the young Clay, the greatest amateur basketball team ever assembled occupied a separate universe. The Americans routed Italy in their first game, despite playing with an unfamiliar grapefruit-colored object that looked more like a volleyball. The 1960 Olympic co-captains, who would become two of the best to ever play the game, were America in microcosm, city and country. Oscar Robertson, who emerged from the basketball frenzy of inner-city Indianapolis. And Jerry West of cozy Cabin Creek, West Virginia, who cherished the endless possibilities that ran through his imagination.
Now I remember when I was about 10 years old, I used to imagine that the high school that I played for would win the state championship. And that I would make the last second shot, and I could miss that shot 10 times, but yet I found a way that in a 5-second period to shoot 10 shots. It can't happen, but I really mentally could never let myself not make that last shot.
Tiny Cabin Creek is pinched between a dark winding river and hills enriched by coal. In the haze of the early mornings, the little boy remembers fishing with trepidation, afraid a 50-pound catfish would lock onto his line and pull him below. There was more security in the backyard and the simple act of shooting a ball through a rim, again and again and again.
As a basketball player, when I started playing, the only reason I played was it was something to do to occupy the incredible amount of time. You know, we did not have a car. We didn't have a television set for a long time. And so there weren't many things to do in a small town like that. And I've often wondered if I would have been raised anywhere else with any other impetus in my life, how that would have affected the outcome of my life as it is today.
Indianapolis, Indiana. A used basketball, a half dozen kids, a game played on a dusty, vacant lot. This was how Oscar Robertson began. A scene humble, yet magical. A bigger playground was later found, more competition, a concrete surface. Yet even when young Robertson and company graduated from the dirt, it was still called Dust Bowl Basketball.
You got a collection of all the greatest talent within blocks, and most of the kids who lived there were all black. And this is what you had. You had talent, raw ability, all converging, just trying to win. And the big thing was to win to stay up on the court. When you won, the winners kept on playing, losers had to take a seat.
Even now, yesterday at the Dust Bowl is warmly recalled by a circle of friends. Dr. Bill Swatz, Herschel Turner, high school coach Ray Crow, and high school teammate Bill Scott.
We wanted to play with Oscar, so really we started to have substitution. Yeah. five of us would play Oscar this time, we win, then he'd have maybe two different guys the next time. Yeah, so really, nobody really wanted to play against him. You know, everybody wanted to be on his team. So he worked it out that way where everybody could play on his team, maybe by all 10 of us. You know, but we'd have to play four or five at a time.
And you all would be champs.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Oscar Robertson made them champs in high school, too, when winning at anything, meant so much. The kids from the Dust Bowl all went to Crispus Attucks because they had to. It was the designated and only high school for blacks in Indianapolis. But the basketball state tournament, then and still the most celebrated in the nation, that was integrated, and it offered a rare opportunity. In 1955, guided by Robertson, the Crispus Attucks Tigers became the first all-black school to win the Indiana State Championship. In 1956, winning the title again, they were the first team ever to finish a season undefeated, 32-0. In Rome, in a pivotal opening round summit against the Soviets, the Dust Bowler and Country Kid were surrogate Cold Warriors, shooting for their country's honor.
When we came here, I don't think anything really mattered except we had to beat the Russian team. We had to beat this Russian team. And it was like our country's philosophy, the democratic way of life that we had against a communistic way of life.
The final was Democracy 81, Communism 57. Only weak opposition lay ahead. On the track, however, the Soviets were savoring a major upset. Two of their high jumpers smoking the American world record holder John Thomas, leaving Thomas with a tarnished bronze. And it seemed as if the new sprint sensation might be grounded prematurely, Wilma Rudolph spraining her ankle during a light workout. Rudolph's counterpart on the men's team was Ray Norton. On September 1st, 1960, he approached the 100 meters supremely confident. And why not? The United States hadn't lost the event since 1928.
I was one of the co-favorites to win three gold medals, and I predicted three gold medals. I guess all sprinters at that period in time idolized Jesse Owens, and I watched movies and studied Jesse Owens like, if he knew how I studied him, he probably, you know, chored to me, you know. But, I just knew what was gonna happen, and I could just see myself like I saw Jesse in 36.
Norton was last in the 100. America's fastest man had fizzled before the world. Not a week old, Rome was turning into a red, white, and blue disappointment. Friday, September 2nd, the gloom generated by Norton's unexpected defeat was erased in 11 seconds by a young American from Clarksville, Tennessee. La Gazelle, as the French writers called him. Wilma Rudolph ran the fastest 100 meters in women's track history. Despite a sprained left ankle, heavily taped, she won the race by almost 10 feet. Age 20, few in the Stadio Olimpico knew just how remarkable this victory was, because Wilma Rudolph spent much of her childhood struggling just to walk.
Well, Wilma, we would always tease her as she got older because she actually was spoiled. She was sickly, so I think she really used that to the utmost. We did everything for her. Her dishes, I can even remember picking her up and taking her from one room to the other.
Clarksville, Tennessee, 40 miles south of Nashville. She was the 19th of Ed Rudolph's 22 children. born prematurely, later contracting pneumonia and scarlet fever. The side effect was a crippled left leg. She was 4 years old, forced into braces, and what was perhaps most painful, isolation. Sister Yvonne, the next oldest, was her closest confidant.
I think the brace to Wilma meant that she was not like the other children, that she was different. And I think it made her feel very bad. It made her feel, so to speak, unworthy. And I think that had a great deal to do with her determination.
At 8 years old, after years of hospital treatment, years of family members massaging her withered leg, there came a memorable Sunday when the braces and the high-top orthopedic shoes were no longer needed.
It was like a whole new little girl. And after that, it was like she knew that she was no different, and it gave her more confidence at that point.
That Sunday, Wilma was due to speak at the Mount Olive Baptist Church, and the congregants witnessed what might be called a little miracle.
And Wilma, it was her turn, and when she got up, you didn't hear her braces. And she went up on the stage and she said her speech very loud and very proud. And she took a bow. And everybody in the church cheered for her. And she was just very, very happy. You know, I think back now, people think that we were poor. But we had everything because we had each other.
Her triumph in the 100 meters, this first Olympic gold, was a tribute to a family's refusal to surrender. Yet moments after the medal ceremony, incredibly, she offered this prize above all prizes to close friend Ray Norton, then battling despair.
It was a very touching moment. And Wilma had just won her 100 meters and offered me her gold medal. I said, keep it. But it was very thoughtful and kind of Wilma, you know. It was just, that's the kind of person she was, by the way. She thought of others. And I mean, so much that she was going to give me her gold medal. I don't think anyone knows that story because it was said to me very quietly, and just to me. Yeah, so it was very touching.
Sunday, September 4th. No events scheduled. With a four-day break, U.S. basketball players were roaming Europe.
Dum, 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 dum.
And back home, America was awakening to allegations about Ray Norton, how its top sprinter had been felled by La Dolce Vita. Norton had become a marked man, and when he escorted Wilma Rudolph around the Olympic Village, 18-year-old Cassius Clay was a shadowy presence.
Like I said, he had this big crush on Wilma, and I could see it in his eyes. So when I see him looking at Wilma, I put my arms around her, you know, and kiss her on the cheek just to annoy him because he had this big mouth, you know.
Louisville, before dawn, 3022 Grand Avenue. And once, this was a typical day in his young life. Cassius Clay rising with his brother Rudy. Sweats, army boots, shaking off the night's sleep. A familiar three-mile route around Chickasaw Park. Precocious dedication, knowing that this is what boxers do. Knowing that the morning begins with pain. Neighbor Lawrence Montgomery witnessed the daily routine.
The thing that fascinated me is that when they would run down there, they would run back, then they would want to shadow box into my hands. They always asked me to hold my hands up so they could shadow box. And I would always tell them they had this cigar tree in their yard, they could shadow box with that. But they were really enthused about training at a young age like that. And Muhammad told me himself that he was going to be the heavyweight champ at that time.
Miles around Chickasaw Park wasn't enough, though. Not when your ambition is to conquer the world. So young Cassius and his brother didn't ride the school bus. They tried instead to outrace it. Three more miles. They claimed it was a rare day when the bus reached Central High School before they did.
And the other children would be looking outside the window, laughing at them while they were running beside the bus. But that's what they wanted to do, I guess, to become in shape. So I don't know if they beat the bus or not, but they did it every day, every day.
A childhood episode may explain how one so young could be so motivated. 12 years old, and his bike had been stolen. Seeking swift justice, Cassius found an off-duty police officer who just happened to run a boxing program. Joe Martin.
He told me about him stealing it, and he says, "I'm going to whip him." I said, "Do you know how to fight? How do you know you're going to whip him?" Well, he got to talking to me. He says, "What is this all about?" And he said, I said, "It's a boxing program." And I said, "If you already come down here and learn," he says, "Can I come down here?" I said, "Yeah, sure you can."
With the local cop in his corner, Clay would build an amateur record of 100 victories and only 8 defeats. Six years ago, so long ago in this largest of lives, long before his body submitted to decades of punishment. 36 years ago, he won the most important bout of his amateur career.
This was before he became the greatest, the legend. Boy. It's like looking at his legs and how they move in and out, and he's got such a good spring to it.
He's bleeding from the mouth of it.
And it's like it's a hard task, but it's
just saved the greatest.
On a rainy afternoon, watching with Olympic teammates, the black and white figure seems distant, but not the memories.
Going backwards, right hand, good right hand. Backwards. So he made the fight.
That jab was working.
Yeah.
Ain't one, I'll eat
another one.
18 years old in Rome, but already beautifully muscled, exquisitely skilled, already shuffling. Already holding his gloves by his waist, daring opponents to mark his soft features. A sweet departure in a brutal game. Monday, September 5th, the Palazzo dello Sport. He defeated Poland's Ziggy Petrakowski, a careful veteran dizzied by boxing's future. America had another goal. The Louisville teenager had something to show the star of the women's team, provided he could chase her down. The women's 200 meters, under darkening skies, Wilma Rudolph was outrunning the rest of the world again.
Wilma Rudolph of the United States in the lead. Jutta Heimann of Germany in second place. It's Wilma Rudolph leading.
Not long after the second gold was around Wilma Rudolph's shoulders, the days of killing humidity finally yielded to a cleansing rain. Day one competition in the decathlon had to be suspended to be resumed hours later. As expected, a duel for the decathlon gold had developed between Taiwan's C.K. Yang and America's Rafer Johnson. In 1959, Yang became a UCLA student in order to train with Johnson. And despite a deep-seated rivalry, they'd become close friends.
Not going.
Looks like I'm going to win this game.
They also shared the same coach, Ducky Drake. This was an extraordinary triangle.
Before we went to Rome, he said, CK, Rafer, I don't give a damn who is going to win. You all, my boys.
Day one of the 1960 decathlon concluded near midnight. Only a miserable shot put kept Yang from a big lead. The steadier Johnson was ahead by a slight 55 points, and the decathlon not the kind of lead that makes for a good night's sleep.
Dad worked in the railroad, and so the section hands, the people who worked in the railroad, they were given housing. And the house, it wasn't literally a boxcar, but it was narrow and shaped very much like a boxcar. And that's where we first lived. And the cannery was actually on both sides of our property. In fact, eventually a place that I worked. In fact, all kids worked at one time or another in the cannery.
Placid, Kingsburg, California. As children, this is what it was for Rafer Johnson and his brother Jimmy. Endless summers in a Garden of Eden.
There's every kind of fruit you can probably think of grows there. Peaches, apples, pears, grapes. And growing up as a kid, it was like a slice out of Tom Sawyer. The San Joaquin Valley, the temperatures would get up into the hundreds, be 110 in the shade, and the kids would just strip down to their shorts and jump in the river.
Their swimming hole was called the Second Drop, a wide, deep ditch used to irrigate the nearby grape fields. Jimmy was a poor swimmer. 11 years old, he'd gotten separated from the group when he slipped and fell in.
And I went under, and I'll never forget, it was an incredible sensation as I went under in slow motion. In a certain amount of time, I had moved through the non-turbulent water area, and now I reached the turbulent water area, which picked me up pretty quickly and was scooting me away.
We were laying in the grape fields up there in Kingsburg, and I went over, and he had disappeared. And he finally came up, and we saw him, so I jumped in and got him out. And I think from that point on, it was like, it was a very, very, very special bond that I had with him.
It was his face that I kept, was kind of coming into focus and going out of focus because he's sitting right over me. I think at that particular moment, I knew I had a great brother. I had a brother that was godlike, and I always looked up to him for direction. But he took on an aura after that event that he truly became my hero.
His passage into manhood was marvelously fluent. In high school, he was the class president, the three-sport star. At UCLA, the first black in his fraternity, elected student body president. By age 23, an athlete of such substance, he was named the 1958 Sports Illustrated Sportsman of the Year. The last day of his life as an athlete was Tuesday, September 6, 1960. Rafer Johnson awoke for day two of the decathlon with little sleep, haunted by his only glaring failure, the decathlon silver 4 years before. Knowing, too, his competition was as dedicated and as capable as he was.
It was a very interesting process. Whenever I competed against or with him, we were really a team. I didn't want to see CK do poorly in anything. If it happened, it wasn't because I had wished it on him, and I felt he felt the same about me. And I think I was a better athlete in my total package with CK than I would have been without him.
Johnson's slim day one lead was gone after the first event of day two. Yang almost a full second better in the hurdles. Event number six, the discus, now already crucial. Johnson, with his well-muscled upper body, had the advantage, and he seized the opportunity, regaining the lead. Then another swing event, the pole vault, Yang's specialty. Yet even with the gold in question, CK was still counseling his UCLA teammate.
By working with him, it helped me a lot too, so vice versa, you know. Like, we help each other, I know, but that's why we became a very good friend instead of just a competitor, you know.
Amid circumstances that should have divided them, Johnson used tips from Yang to sky higher than ever before, retaining his lead. So it would be settled in the final event. To win the gold, Yang had to outrun Johnson by 10 seconds in the 1500. One last time, the triangle convened. Two friends, one coach.
And just before the 1500 meters, I went over and talked to Duck in. He gave me a strategy, and as I went back towards the starting line, I saw CK go.
Ducky told CK to open a gap in the final quarter mile. He told Rafer that he should prepare for a hellish final sprint. Johnson's personal best in the 1500 was 15 seconds slower than Yang's. But this would be Johnson's final race. He'd wreck his body if he had to, run at the edge of consciousness.
I tried to run a little bit faster, and then I looked back a little bit. He was right behind me.
CK had outrun Rafer by just 2 seconds, not 10. Johnson's last 1500 was the fastest of his life.
As good as I felt about winning the gold, I just knew that he had to be equally disappointed, so I wanted to be next to him. And we actually leaned on each other, too. We were both very tired. And I think we held each other up, but it was a fact that I had to be next to my friend. And one of the great moments for me was to be in those last few moments just walking with him along the track.
After 2 days and nights, 10 events, 8 seconds was the difference between silver and gold. Thursday, September 8th. Double gold medalist Wilma Rudolph would be competing in her third and final event, the 4x100-meter relay. The three other women she'd be running with were among her closest friends in the world. Their coach was Ed Temple.
The race that I think that she wanted more than anything else was the 4x100 relay. And that was because her teammate had been in the 100, in the 200, and they didn't win any medals. And this was the only chance that they were going to get to win a medal. And she was determined. She was determined that they were going to win a gold medal.
Wilma was part of a team within a team. The top U.S. female sprinters were all Tiger Bells from Tennessee A&I, the school later renamed Tennessee State. Rome's withering heat posed no real problem for any of them. At home in Nashville, the cinder track was a vast frying pan, so they protected their fingertips with adhesive tape. They trained months for one meet, the Tuskegee Relays in Alabama. At sunrise every year, the Tiger Bells departed in Coach Temple's station wagon.
We would take a brown bag from the cafeteria here with a peanut butter sandwich and an orange or an apple. Of course, we couldn't stop and eat at a restroom because, you know, it was segregation at that time. And then if you wanted to go to the restroom, maybe if you stop at a gasoline station, you could go. But 9 times out of 10, what you couldn't even do that. You'd have to pull over to the side, and they'd have to hit the field.
The overnight bonding by station wagon, three-a-day practices under the persistent reign of Coach Temple, it had all brought them to this moment. A very special Thursday in Rome, 5:55 p.m., and in lane 4, America was represented by one college, the Tennessee State Tiger Bells.
And I know before they ran, they got in a group, a huddle there, and prayed. And she told Lucinda, you just get me the baton. You get me the baton.
Wilma's Olympic roommate, Lucinda Williams, was the third leg of the relay.
I think it was the most fantastic 110 yards that she had ever run in her life, because she came from behind. But we knew once she got that baton that it didn't matter who was ahead, she was going to catch them.
Once a child who could not walk, She became now the first American woman to run for three golds in one Olympics. The last, a shared sister act, was the most gratifying of all. Saturday, September 10th. On this foreign court, Oscar Robertson and Jerry West played Brazil for the gold medal.
I think about the last time I dunked was in this building.
In two Olympic weeks, a bond formed that survived what followed, a long, intense rivalry as they became two of the best guards in NBA history.
You know, Oscar, it seems so strange to be out here. You know, we're not exactly 20 years old anymore.
Sure.
They began building parallel resumes in high school when they took their teams to state titles. Each also suffered the deep sting of losing in the college Final Four. The son of a sanitation worker, the son of a mechanic, so much alike, but in one way, always divided.
When I traveled, my mother and father would always tell me, when I went down south, sit in the back of the bus. Do not go into the white restaurants because they wouldn't let you in anyway. Don't drink at the white fountains. Those things were all told to me. So when I come to the University of Cincinnati, it didn't shock me that I was denied opportunities that the other players easily took for granted.
Indignities chased Oscar Robertson through college. He was kicked out of a Houston hotel with a whites-only policy, delivered a death threat enclosed in a Christmas card by the Imperial Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan. Taunted at games, even pelted in one case by coins and food. This was an upside-down existence for one judged by most to be the best college player of his day. For a time, Jerry West was sequestered on the other side of the color barrier. At West Virginia, he had become the embodiment of all that was good. In 1960, his Mountaineers hosted Villanova and George Raveling, the first black to ever play at Morgantown, West Virginia. Like Oscar Robertson, Raveling's life had made him wary. But just before tip-off, West found Raveling at mid-court and shook his hand. The gesture was simple, but significant.
At that point in time, you know, he's a really nice guy. And those are things that you can sense in athletes. You know who the nice people are, and you know who the horses behinds are that you play against. And he was a nice guy. And I wanted him to feel comfortable when he played there, period.
America's unresolved social troubles were an ocean away in Rome on that Saturday night in September of 1960, as the U.S. Olympic team made the gold medal game against Brazil anticlimactic. It was 14-2 after 5 minutes. And at game's end, the co-captains came forward to accept the medals for the Olympic champs.
For he and I to stand there and take that medal for the country, it meant a lot. It meant brotherhood, it meant togetherness, it meant that we shared a lot of great moments together, and something that can never be taken away from us at all.
Even today, when I die, that will be the thing that probably, in my athletic career, of all the things that ever happened to me, that will be the thing that probably will stand out most in my athletic career.
September 11th, 1960. The Rome Games became history with one final ceremony of glory and innocence. But that innocence would quickly fade. Rome's single tragedy, the death of Danish cyclist Knut Jensen, turned out to be man-made. Jensen was killed by a dangerous blood stimulant. The incident prompted Olympic officials to establish drug testing. South Africa's long exile from the Olympic movement would soon follow, as did a string of Olympiads marked in one way or another by world politics. Some change was welcome. Not long after the Olympic flame had been doused, a long divided town had an extraordinary epiphany, discovering their common humanity. October 4th, 1960 was Wilma Rudolph Day in Clarksville, Tennessee. Downtown, 4,000 people choked Main Street for 10 blocks. That night, there was more. At the local armory, a banquet was held in her honor. 1,100 guests, black and white. The first integrated event in the town's history.
Even now, after 3 weeks, my feelings are desperately hard to explain. Winning the 100 meters and the 200 meters was the greatest thrill of my lifetime. When Martha, Barbara, Lucinda, and I won the 400-meter relay, my happiness was increased beyond measure. In every effort, I had been motivated by one thing: to do justice to those who believe in me and to use my physical talent in the glory of God and to the honor of womanhood.
Back at home, with close friend Ray Norton returning to California, Wilma warmed to the boxing gold medalist living up the road in Louisville. In fact, his charm was becoming hard for anyone to resist.
You know how great I am. I don't have to tell you about my strategy. I tell them, my trainer, say, Bodine, come here. Bodine, tell him, what are we going to do?
You're going to float like a butterfly and sting like a bee.
Ah, rumble, young man, rumble. That's what we're going to do. You heard it. That's my trainer. He'll tell you.
In order to break, stop punching and step back. Good luck. Take hands.
Miami Beach, February 25th, 1964. A battered Sonny Liston doesn't answer the bell for the seventh round. A day later, the new heavyweight champion of the world changes his name to Muhammed Ali.
I shook up the world! 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 I shook up the world!
He would box for almost two decades, and it appears the lingering price of thousands of blows is a condition called Parkinson's syndrome, slowing his movements, making speech difficult. His pride implores him to hide now from the world, but his faith, the sense that he can still do some good, compels him to lead one of the world's most public lives, his wife, Lani Ali.
Muhammad doesn't have anything that's terminal, and he lives every day of his life to the fullest, and every day the way he wants to live it. Yes, he has slowed down some. It has affected him a little bit, but it's not that it has affected his outlook on life or his disposition or anything else. His attitude has always been positive.
Oh, shit. Whoa. Okay, I stop. That's it. Turn around. I do it.
And each day, he reminds those closest to him of the nobility of his spirit. After Rome, Oscar Robertson's basketball skills were accompanied by his determination to make a difference. He became president of the NBA Players Association when union membership was thought to be a dangerous exercise in futility. He now runs the nation's largest minority-owned chemical company. After his retirement as a player, Jerry West would become part of the Lakers' renaissance as scout, then general manager, quietly helping guide them to five championships, yet always at heart, the solitary kid from Cabin Creek. Though victory was never again as simple and sweet as it was for each in Rome, though each waited years for another taste of a basketball championship, it did finally happen late in their athletic lives. An NBA title, a just reward for gifts shared during Hall of Fame careers. The wave of near anarchy that was the 60s cost Rafer Johnson a close friend. On June 5th, 1968, he was at Robert Kennedy's side as the presidential candidate lay dying in Los Angeles, assassinated. Johnson never returned to politics, instead channeling his need to serve into a new frontier, a movement launched by Kennedy's sister Eunice on behalf of the mentally retarded, the Special Olympics. Some men see things as they are, and ask why. I dream things that never were and ask why not. The words of Robert Kennedy, a message kept alive by the man who in 1984 ignited a symbol of the long-held hope for global understanding.
And he lit that torch, and I know for a fact that all of those people out there that were looking was feeling the same way that I was feeling. I'm saying, that is my brother. And each one of those people were always also saying, that is my brother. And that's the legacy of Rafer Johnson.
On November 12, 1994, Wilma Rudolph, one of the wonders of Rome, was lost to brain cancer. She was 54.
And I would just say that all young women, if you have an opportunity to learn or to study or to read about the life of Wilma Rudolph, do that, because it's an inspiration to anyone who chooses to want to be successful, because life is precious. Live it to the fullest each day, but also look at the individuals who paved the way for you to be where you are today.
At her funeral, Clarksville Mayor Don Trotter recalled her homecoming from Rome 34 years before. When Wilma notified the city, she wouldn't appear at a segregated parade. Wilma brought Clarksville together that way in her life, Trotter said, and today, in her passing, she brought Clarksville together again. Wilma Rudolph, Muhammad Ali, Rafer Johnson, Oscar Robertson, Jerry West. Five of the most extraordinary athletes in American history. They all shared a simple, daring notion. Early born and never lost. Why walk when you can fly?
In this world there's a whole lot of trouble, baby. In this world there's a whole lot of pain. In this world there's a whole lot of trouble, but a whole lot of ground to gain. Why take when you could be giving? Why watch as the world goes by? It's a hard enough life to be living. Why walk?